Good evening. With me to discuss Labour's winter crisis with the Chancellor, I have David Basnett of the Municipal Workers, Moss Evans of the Transport Workers, and Terry Duffy of the Engineering Union. Gentlemen, you would expect me to start with the Chancellor, and I will. Mr. Healey, can you explain to me, and through me to the nation, why the government has not yet called a state of emergency?
The answer is very simple. The only purpose of a state of emergency is to give the government powers which it doesn't have in normal circumstances. This government doesn't think it makes sense to have a state of emergency as a political stunt and then not to use any of the powers it gives you. The last government did do that on one or two occasions. And we do not at the present time need the powers that a state of emergency would give us. And we think particularly on the road haulage dispute that to use troops on a very large scale and requisition other vehicles to deal with some of the problems would reduce rather than increase the flow of materials to the hospitals and to industry. But we have made it clear this afternoon, for example, that without calling a state of emergency, we will, if needed, on Monday, get the military to help in dealing with industrial action in the emergency ambulance service in London. And of course, we'd do so if we thought it would help in the Pennines with the water dispute.
Can we be quite sure, Chancellor, that you're not being calm as a political stunt?
I think so. I'm not a political stuntman at all. I think that's a thing which I leave to other people.
Chancellor, a week ago you said that the unions were pushing us, the nation, near the edge of a precipice. Today we had no trains, we have shortages of all kinds developing around the country, there are people in the north of this country who haven't got fresh water. How much nearer the edge of the precipice are we?
I think we are a bit nearer. I think that public opinion is getting fed to the teeth with some of the things that are going on, and that in itself creates real problems for the nation. I think, on the other hand, that the industrial situation is not at present as bad as I expected it to be just a week ago when I forecast 1 million out of work by the end of this week. As you know, the CBI and the government both agree now that they're only so far about 130,000 out of work. But of course, that's 130,000, far too many. In short, I would say the situation is worse, but not as much worse as we all had reason to fear 7 days ago.
How far away is the precipice?
Well, I think there are two senses in which there's a precipice. The first would be if the unjustified use of industrial action produced a backlash of fury among the population.
Is Mr. Evans' use of industrial action unjustified?
I think it'd be helpful if you let me finish a sentence before you ask me another question.
I'll make every effort.
Thank you. I think the first risk is of a tremendous public backlash against things that are going on, leading to very unwise action in some areas. The second danger is of a much more widespread industrial layoff than we get today. A lot of firms at the moment are clinging on to people who haven't anything really to do, and you could find a very big increase in layoffs in the coming week. But I think the most dangerous thing in the long run is not the immediate industrial problem. It's the risk that some of the settlements which have been made recently will become the going rate, and then we could be back to the sort of crisis we had in 1975. On that issue, at the moment, so far things are not worse, but they're no better. The risk is there, and I hope that everybody is beginning to recognise it more than perhaps they did a week ago.
Is Mr. Evans' dispute an unjustified dispute?
It's never for governments to argue about the justice of disputes between private employers and private employees. I think there are aspects of industrial action which it's not possible to justify, and which indeed Mr. Evans has not sought to justify. I think it's very important that the Transport and General Workers Union has issued instructions to all its members now engaging in this dispute to observe the sort of code of practice on picketing which we have always wanted and which I see Mrs. Thatcher was asking for yesterday. That, I think, is important progress. And don't forget that one reason why we've had fewer layoffs so far in this dispute than we all expected a week ago is that the Transport and General Workers Union has succeeded, since the strike became official, in establishing some but not adequate control.
Right, let me now turn to Mr. Evans. Mr. Evans, it is true that you have made efforts to control secondary picketing, and you have today issued further instructions which should in fact, I believe, put a stop to it. But given that you weren't able to control your members completely beforehand, what makes you think you can control them now?
Well, first of all, I think it's important to recognise that this is the first industrial dispute in the transport industry of the size that it is today for 46 years. We've tried very, very hard to check what sort of dispute of such a character had happened before, and I think it was 46 years ago. Now, someone has coined a phrase, secondary picketing, and I tell you quite frankly, I've been a trade union official for 23 years, and I had to study very carefully the new sort of terminology used. And when I started to understand what it meant, quite frankly, I thought, well, perhaps we ought to look at whether we were doing something wrong or not. In other words, whether we were doing something that perhaps we hadn't been doing for the last 50 or 60 years. And I find in many, many cases that we aren't doing anything wrong at all. But nevertheless, it is important, I think, for the government to draw to our attention, as it has done, that there are certain serious problems which need to be dealt with and can be dealt with by agreement between us, rather than seek, if you like, an order or place something before Parliament which would bring about a state of emergency. Now, I'm happy, therefore, answering your last point, that what we've decided today will help considerably overcome some of the difficulties that we've experienced. In other words, we have...
Can you control your members, is what I'm asking you, Mr. Evans.
Well, I've never... You see, control to me is a word which has great emotive terms. I try to control in the sense that what I'm doing is with the consent of the membership. And I believe that the code of conduct which we've asked our membership to observe as a consequence of our discussions with the representatives of the government, I think that they will accept them by consent. I don't think I'll have to exercise control in order...
Will you exercise control? Are you prepared to discipline members of your union by either branching them or by other means if they refuse to, if they continue with secondary picketing of places that have got nothing to do with the dispute in question?
Well, without dodging the question, I couldn't give you a specific answer to a hypothetical situation. You see, you can't say that you will discipline members for doing X, Y, Z. What I haven't done is to lay down a law. That is to say that we haven't, as a consequence of our discussions with the government, lay down any form of legislation in which there are penalties attached. Immediately you start doing that, I think that as a natural individual who believes in freedom, you start to get people's backs up. So what we've attempted to do is, in fact, lay down a code of conduct, which I think people will naturally observe. Now, if you start, as I said before, if you start saying, well, if you don't observe it, this is the penalty, and this is what you're asking me to spell out to you, will I penalize? What will be, for example, the sentence passed on individuals in the event of them not observing literally the code of conduct? I can't tell you at this stage.
I'm not quite sure, Mr. Evans, whether you've told me you can control your members or whether you can't.
Well, you see, the trade union movement in the sense of controlling, and I've used that word in the sense that you mean it, it's an emotive term. And, you know, you can't control them like as though you've got a load of shock troops standing by a transport house, so that in the event of them not behaving themselves,
Chancellor, are you happy with the way this is going to be operated, or don't you really think in the long run you are going to have to call a state of emergency?
I've no idea. I'd prefer to wait and see. What I do think, however, is that Mr. Len Murray was absolutely right in saying yesterday that a small number of people involved in this dispute are discrediting the trade union movement as a whole and exposing it to very serious risks in public esteem and the risks of an irrational, in my view, backlash. And I hope that the trade union leaders will succeed in establishing the power of leadership. Nobody's talking about control here, but leadership in a democratic movement, which will enable these practices to be brought to an end, because I think there is grave danger for the country, and even graver danger, if I may say so, for the trade union movement if they fail.
David Basnett, may I bring you in now? Next week, local authority workers, many of whom are numbered among your members, will be having a one-day action stoppage day in support of a 40% claim. This week, the Prime Minister made substantial concessions to lower-paid workers. Did he go far enough? Are you satisfied with those concessions?
Well, let me deal with those concessions first, and I'd like to identify what the claim is, because you're misstating it in a serious way.
Not deliberately, Mr. Basnett.
No, I'm sure it's not deliberate. Obviously, I prefer the negotiators to examine what has been proposed in Parliament and to see what advantage they can take on it, whether they can build on it for our membership. And that's exactly what the negotiators are doing at the moment. And I think it's silly of a General Secretary to try and catch a headline by commenting on it. The negotiators are doing that, and they'll go on doing it. I just make one comment. There's a proposal for an inquiry. Now, quite obviously, with the problems in the public services, and I'll come to those when I discuss the claim itself, with the problems in the public services, we're not talking about jam tomorrow, and the proposal is it's the jam the day after tomorrow, but something's got to be done quickly, and I'm sure that's what the negotiators are pushing for at the moment.
But 40% isn't possible, is it? I mean, you listen to what the Chancellor said, what the government is saying. 40% is surely, and that kind of figure, that's madness you're talking about, isn't it?
Well, shall I tell you what the claim is, and then you can reinterpret it?
You can briefly, Mr. Basnett.
I'll do it very briefly, yes. Firstly, we're not asking for anything that's above average. You see, these people are in a situation where their average earnings are £22 a week, £1,000 a year, over £1,000 a year, below what the average industrial worker earns. So it's not above average. They've got a brutalising low pay problem, which is important. Some of them on the basic rate get less than people on Social Security. And the offer in several parts is ridiculous. The part-time women workers are only offered 1.7%. So that's one thing. And we're really not asking the government to do anything that's unique. We've had the firemen as an exception, the police, the doctors, the dentists, the air traffic control assistants, and recently the BBC. And they're all higher paid than these people, so there's nothing unique in looking at a question, a problem like this, and dealing with it uniquely. The claim is completely and absolutely justified.
Can we have yet more exceptions, Chancellor?
No, I don't think we can. I think it's important that this settlement, which will be the first big settlement in the public service, should be within the guidelines, and I think a settlement which is fair can be found. You see, the average earnings of the full-time adult male in the local authority manual group is fallen a little bit behind the peak level relative to average earnings at which it was at in 1975. It's 2.5% behind. Still ahead of the level it was at in 1974, just over 1% ahead. Now, I believe that given the government concession to the poorer paid people to whom Mr. Basnett was referring, which will give everybody under £70 a week more than 5% and proportionately more as their current wages are lower, I think that it does offer, Mr. Fisher quantified it for his members in the group as an extra 2%. I think that's very fair, particularly if you add to it the promise of a really thorough comparability study which will enable objective people agreed by the unions and the employers to find out whether in fact people in the local authority area are getting the rate for the job compared with people in private industry. Now, I don't think anything fairer than that can be devised.
May I just comment on that, because it is important to realise that these people have fallen dramatically behind since 1974. Mm. The average earnings, in fact, have gone down by £10 a week since then, That's compared with the average earnings for all industrial workers. The basic rate has gone down from two-thirds of average earnings to less than 50% of average earnings.
Well, David, we can't negotiate the claim round the table. I don't agree with your figures, as you know.
But I want the public to know the facts, because we're talking about people who serve the public.
Will you settle within the guidelines, Mr. Basnett?
Getting that, just let me finish this point.
They're
getting that service on the cheap, and it's cheap labour that's doing it. Really, they deserve to be better paid.
Are you prepared to settle within the guidelines? I'm sorry for interrupting you.
We've made it perfectly clear that what we want are two things, really. We want something like the going rate in this industry, and we want a comparability study that's going to, first of all, establish them comparable with the people they serve and keep them in that position in the future.
Let me come to Mr. Duffy, if I may. Yes, I'm sorry, I must bring
Mr. Duffy. Could you keep on about the guidelines? This is what I wanted
to please make. Can you make a very quick point?
Yes, yes. I think it's important to recognise that the guidelines that you're talking about is 5%.
Yes, thank you very much.
With a lot of exceptions, including substantially more than 5% for the low paid, something which I think we should all be very grateful for.
Mr. Duffy, may I bring you in? Because your members were among the pace setters in the car industry at Ford's and other places. If the lorry drivers end up with between 15 and 20%, is there any way you can can settle for your members in the Confederation under that kind of figure? And if you do end up with that kind of figure, aren't you all really engaged in a kind of collective madness of saying yah boo to the government, we're not listening to all your warnings?
Well, answering the latter part of your question immediately, I can say that we're very distressed with the fact that we are misusing the strike weapon. We're not a tremendous amount of misery being created nationwide, and in a democracy, unfortunately, we are forced to have that, but we need to find ways and means of securing a fair and equitable wage structure nationwide, and the trade union itself must take an analysis of the present position and remedy the faults that have been highlighted in the recent months. Going back to the engineer's claim, or into anyone's claim, whether it be the miners or whether it be the power workers, if they detect that someone elsewhere is eroding a differential with them and obtaining, it precipitates a consequential claim for them. So whatever settlement is obtained, it means that other bargaining units request the same form of percentage settlement. That has happened. But in recent months, I've been refreshed to find that people have looked not only at the guidelines, but on the company's ability to pay. Because the trade union movement are committed, together with the government, to defeat inflation. We believe that's a prerequisite to obtaining a fair and equitable society. And if we're going to maintain the purchasing power of not only of our members, but the old and the sick, the unemployed, then there's a need, a prerequisite is to ensure that we combat inflation. So we're together with the government in doing that.
But it's like being against sin, isn't it?
I think Mr. Duffy has described the nature of the precipice very exactly. Now, I gave figures in Parliament this afternoon of settlements so far. The great majority of settlements have been within the guidelines, including, incidentally, a very big one in your union, Mr. Duffy, at British Leyland. And I see that there's been a return to work in Barnoldswick for Rolls-Royce today for a guideline settlement after a strike which had lasted some time. Now, we have had some breaches, mainly in companies where there were breaches last year, like British Oxygen and Ford, but in most cases the breaches have been at a good deal lower level than last year, and so far with nearly 15, perhaps 20% of people in wage bargaining already having settled, the total excess is only 0.5% over what the government has been asking for. Now, if we can do no worse than that, then the outturn will be rather worse than we expected, but not disastrous.
It's a fairly big if, isn't it?
Now, I'm putting this through you, Mr. Gardner, to my trade union friends here, and through them to the nation and to their members. If we can keep settlements roughly where they have been and not establish a new high going rate, we can keep inflation under control. But if every time there's a breach of the guidelines, an excessive settlement, everybody who comes later says, we've got to have the same, regardless of the state of industry, That is a recipe for a return to 1975. And I know that nobody around this table, and I think very few people in the country, want to go back to the days of confetti money, heavy cuts in public expenditure, and increases in taxation.
I must bring Moss
but
in.
That yeah. inevitably will happen.
Moss has been waiting to reply to both you and Mr. Duffy. Sorry.
The validity of our policy.
Sorry,
well, this
Chancellor.
This is very, very unfair because, you see, you're expressing a point of view, Chancellor, if I may say so, that the only way that people can improve their standards of life is by exercising restraint. Because this is what we're talking about. Now, the trade union movement in Britain lent the maximum support in 1975, 76 and 77, despite our disagreements, for example, about free collective bargaining, we nevertheless decided that we should have a 12-month standstill. Now, any nation that has, if you like, an income policy, whether it's statutory or voluntary, at some time or another has got to have what they call a re-entry. In a free democratic society, there must be some sort of re-entry into what we call normal collective bargaining.
Well, we because once the trade union responsible
the
as
trade
well as
union
normal.
Movement, the trade union movement in Britain, as I understand it, is a free trade union movement. It's not an agent of the state. It's not an adjunct of the state. And it doesn't want to lend itself to become a corporate state. So the purpose of seeking its cooperation is during periods of crisis. And during periods of crisis, you make a sacrifice. Once these sacrifices have been made, surely you're entitled then to be able to bargain freely with the employer. In other words, say to the employer, I want to sell my
I think
my
your
labor.
Point's made, Mr. Evans.
No, with respect.
No, Chancellor,
I
would prefer you to take Mr. Basnett's point together with that,
of course,
because I'm in
yes.
time problems.
Yes.
Well, I'm just going to say very quickly that none of us can be satisfied or happy with the current situation. There are very clearly problems. And I think it'd be more useful to discuss how on earth we got here and how we got out of it. Because this exchange about the current situation is interesting, and the figures are probably pouring out of people's minds at the moment without really understanding the situation. Now, I think it's useful to look at how we got here. And we can start from where Moss started. We did make sacrifices in phase one and phase two, and the trade union movement at that period itself monitored and kept the incomes policy. And it is a fact that you only have successful incomes policies when you have the acquiescence and cooperation, and that's clearly what we did. But beyond that, we said, despite the fact that no incomes policy had successfully gone beyond 2 years, we said, we'll give you the 12-month rule to help the re-entry problem. But there's no further than that you can go. And really, what's happened is you've had an exacerbation of a series of problems built up over that period by a continued tight incomes policy. We should have been discussing what the devil do we do when we go to voluntary collective bargaining.
Could I give a quick comment on what's been said? There was no freeze 3 years ago. There was a 10% wage increase. And for many people, that was £6 a week, which they would never have got under normal collective bargaining. Secondly, there was no real sacrifice. People sacrificed confetti money for real money. And last year, we had the biggest increase in living standards for working people in Britain there's been in 1 year at any time since the war. Thirdly, everybody around this table wants to keep inflation down. It cannot be kept down unless wage settlements are kept below around 5% unless they're attended with productivity agreements. And the tragic thing is that some trade union organisers have been actually glorying in the fact that they've got big increases with no productivity attached at all.
Mr. Evans, I'm sorry. Chancellor, Mr. Evans said we cooperated in time of a crisis. Are we still in a crisis for you to need their cooperation?
I make a very simple point. The government can do a lot to control inflation by keeping the pound steady through a strict fiscal and monetary policy. We're doing that. But it can only keep inflation down at the cost of unemployment if it does not have help from the trade unions in responsible collective bargaining.
Now, Could I just make this point very quickly?
You're in the last minute and a half.
Okay, if I could bring to you, Chancellor, an accountant who would present to you, shall we say, a company, in the lorry driver's dispute, who would present to you a company accounts and say that if we conceded for £65 for lorry drivers, then our increases, in fact, would mean to the consumer no more than 5.6%. Do you know that there are many
companies
who can't afford...
You must let the Chancellor answer that point.
Well, it may well be the case, and of course that can be argued. All I'm saying is this. I never wanted a strict pay policy, even in the third round. I hoped that the so-called 10% policy would be an average. But the trouble is, nobody was prepared to take less than the average. It was only people wanted more. Now, I've said to the trade unions, and I say again, and I think we shall be discussing this in the coming weeks, I hope we can find a better way of running this railroad. But it's got to be a way which is consistent with stopping inflation from rising. And the moment that somebody will tell me, whoever they are, Mrs. Thatcher, Mr. Basnett, any of our friends here, a better way of achieving our objective, I'll jump on it like a shot.
And time is jumping on me, gentlemen. Thank you all very much. Good night to you from TVI. That's all.